Trying to teach his horse to obey. to stop and to start on command. This man was a very religious man, so he came up with a couple of religious statements to use in his training of his horse. He trained the horse to go on the command words, "Praise the Lord." He taught the horse to stop on the command word, "Hallelujah." Praise the Lord to go, "Hallelujah" to stop. One day he was riding his horse and the horse got spooked and the horse just took off. He lost control of the horse, and as he lost control of the horse, his mind started going every which way and he forgot his words. The horse had been trained to only respond to these key words. And up ahead was a cliff. And the horse was running to this cliff at full speed. The man began thinking of every religious word he ever heard. Amen. Jesus saves. Worthy. Holy. But nothing worked. And just before the horse approached the edge of the cliff, the man shouted, "Hallelujah!" And the horse stopped right at the edge of the cliff. The man wiped the sweat from his brow. He said, "Whoo! Praise the Lord." Over the last 3 weeks, we have been challenged by the Word of God to get back to the priority of worship. And the reason that we need to get back to the priority of worship, because worship is vital in any church, because our Lord deserves worship. He deserves to be highly exalted above anything and everything else in our lives. We were able to look over the last couple of weeks at two great worship scenes in Scripture. One found in the book of Revelation, the other found in the book of Isaiah. And in both of those scenes, the Lord was front and center. The Lord had the preeminence. He was the focus. If heaven had a red carpet event, I want you to know all eyes would be on Jesus. And if all eyes are on Jesus in glory, it should be the same in our services down here on earth. Our focus this morning should be on the Lamb that was slain for our sins and for that same Lamb who rose again on the third day. He was the focus of Isaiah in that great worship scene, and he was also the focus of that great worship scene the Apostle John was able to see in the book of Revelation. Again, worship is all about the Lord, or it's not worship at all. Now, worship does have participants, and that's where you and I come in onto the scene. We participate in worship. We praise the Lord. We worship people. But we also see that worship reminds us of who we are. It reminds us of how undeserving we really are. It shows us the sinners that we really are, but it also shows us our great need of Him and how deserving He is of our worship. We also have seen over the last couple of weeks that worship should lead a people to a lifetime of faithful service for their King. Quit making excuses and start serving the One who redeemed you through His death on the cross. There's no excuse at all for not serving Jesus. Last week, we looked at the centrality of the Bible in worship. If we're going to worship the Lord in spirit and truth, we must be a people of the book. The Word of God is vital in worship. The reading, the teaching, and preaching of the Word of God is the grand moment in worship services. We should come with Bibles in hand, Bibles open, and ready to hear every Lord's day, "Thus saith the Lord." This morning, we're going to continue to look at worship and another true component or key component to true worship, and that is praise. Praising the Lord should not become some routine tradition in our church services. Amen. Praising the Lord should not become some casual or meaningless activity where we just go through the motions. Praise is one of humanity's response to God because of who He is. Praise, our English word for praise, comes from a Latin word that means value or price. Value or price. So to give the Lord praise really means that you're proclaiming His work, His merit. The word hallelujah is a transliteration of the Hebrew phrase, praise the Lord. The word psalm for the book of Psalms, that word psalm literally means what? Praises or songs. We have been studying the book of Psalms on Wednesday evenings for quite a few years. And in the Psalms, we have found out that you can find sorrow, tears, pain, suffering, trials, difficulties. But what we've also been able to see in the book of Psalms is this: great words of praise. Psalm 150 is a psalm of praise found in the book of Psalms. Wiersbe rightly points out this psalm closes with the highest note of praise. Actually, Psalm 145 through 150 are Hallel psalms, meaning they are songs of praise. If you look back beginning in Psalm 150 and you read to Psalm 150, the very first word out of the psalmist's mouth on each hand is praise the Lord. 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 The word praise in these six verses of Psalm 150 is used 13 times. 13 times in six short verses. And don't miss this. 10 out of the 13 times, the word praise is used in command form. The people of God are commanded to praise the Lord. So this short psalm is devoting all praise, honor, and glory to the Lord, and it gives us some great essentials of worship that should be evident in any Bible-believing congregation. And I believe there are four takeaways that we should see in this short psalm of praise. Number one, we notice right off the bat who we praise. Look again at the very first part of verse number one. The Bible says what?
Praise the Lord.
Just as we have seen in Isaiah, Revelation, and in Nehemiah last week, we see here who we are to praise. The psalmist opens this beautiful psalm with a great but laser-focused command. And that command for the people of God that gather together to worship Him is this: praise the Lord. The word Lord here translated is the word Jehovah. And the psalmist is using this covenant-keeping name of God here. This name for the Lord reminds us each and every morning that our God is good, that our God is love. And if He is a God of love, and if He is a good God, then He is a promise-keeping God. Again, the psalmist is reminding the people that worship is not about the worshipers, but that worship and praise is all about the Lord. When the psalmist and the people came to the house of God, there was obviously one focus and one focus in mind, and that was praise to Almighty God. When you and I came to this place this morning, what was on your mind? Why did you come here for Sunday school? Why did you come here for worship? Why did you participate in congregational singing? Why did the choir get up and sing? The reason each and every one of us are here and should be participating in worship is for a singular yet unified purpose. We have come to praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. We have come today to praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Again, why does the choir sing? Why do you sing as a congregation? For one purpose alone, to praise the Lord. Why I'm up here every Sunday preaching the Word of God? To praise His holy name. We praise Him for who He is and what He has done for each and every one of us. I'm not going to stay here long on this point one because it's been our focus of every message, but I hope that you are here or you're beginning to realize there's only one reason that you are here. If you're born again, washed in the blood, it's to praise His name. Not to act like a bunch of corpses. We're to praise Him and give Him what He deserves. Not only are we instructed on who to praise, right there in verse 1 it tells us where we are to praise. The Bible says, praise God in His sanctuary. Praise God. The word for God there is Elohim. He is creator. It can also be translated that God is all-powerful. He starts off with calling the Lord Jehovah, reminding us He is the promise keeper. He is the covenant-keeping God. And then He uses the word Elohim, which reminds us He has the power to back up His promises. Yeah. So where do we praise Him? Well, I hope that you know that you can praise God anywhere at any time. You can praise Him in your home, and I hope that you do. You can praise Him in your car, even though you might look like a lunatic to some going down the road. I remember, just a little side note, years and years and years ago, when you get to a certain age, you start saying years and years and years ago. But there used to be a cell phone company, kids, called Singular Wireless. It's the AT&T network now. And there was a Singular Wireless office that came here to Sylvester, and one of my friends was in management for that company, and he asked me to run the Sylvester store. So I did. And when I was working there, I just began pastoring at Sumner Baptist. And at times the store would be very busy, people coming in and out, but then the other times you're just sitting around just waiting for somebody to come in. So I had plenty of time to study. And one day there wasn't a soul in the building. And I had my Bible going over it, and I was doing this. I was rehearsing my sermon for that Sunday. And it was a few days later, a person came in and said, "What were you doing yesterday?" I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "I saw you when I came, I drove through going to the dry cleaners, and you were doing it. You were shaking something, and you were talking," and I was like, "Oh my goodness. What were you doing?" I said, "I was preaching to myself. I was praising the Lord." So that's what I'm talking about. People may think that you're a lunatic. But you can praise Him in your home, you can praise Him in your car, you can even praise Him on the job. You can praise the Lord sitting in a cabin in the beautiful mountains or lounging under an umbrella by the beach. You can praise the Lord while fishing on a pond, or you can praise the Lord while playing golf on the golf course. And if you can praise the Lord on the golf course, you are pretty spiritual. Amen. Praise should just simply be the overflow of what God has done for each and every one of us. And it should be shown everywhere. However, there is also a place that we should come on the Lord's day to praise His name with believers from every kindred, every tribe, and it is the church house. We come together and praise God together with the children of God in His sanctuary. The psalmist declared, "I was glad when they said unto me, Let us go into the house of the Lord. Why was the psalmist glad to go to God's house? Because he knew that while he was going to the Lord's house, there would be other believers gathered together there with him, and that they could praise the Lord collectively together. Now, there are some people today that say that they don't need the church nor corporate worship in their relationship with the Lord. I simply say to those people watching, or if there's one in here today, it's this: you don't know your Bible. Because if you knew your Bible, you would know the God that we truly serve. On any given Lord's Day, I firmly believe the Lord's house should be overflowing with grateful people that He has redeemed from their sins. We do not forsake the assembling of ourselves. Why? God has commanded, praise God in His sanctuary. Again, it's not a suggestion. He is commanding that we come together to praise His name. It's a beautiful thing when you can praise the Lord by yourself. But oh, how beautiful it is when all the people of God come together for one purpose, and that is to praise His name. When we come to Isabella Baptist Church, we come for the purpose of corporate worship and praise. Now, I do know, because the Bible teaches it, the Lord does not dwell in structures that we build.
That's right.
He dwells in our lives through the presence of the Holy Spirit. But there is absolutely nothing wrong about setting aside a place in a community for believers to gather together. Actually, it's biblical to set a place aside for believers to come together. What is unbiblical are those who call themselves people of God, who turn up their noses at corporate times of praise and worship. That is unbiblical. If you don't believe me, go to the book of Acts and you will see the early church met together. It might have been in the temple. It might have been in homes. It might have been in upper rooms, in synagogues, or were they on the run for their life, even in caves. But the key is this: they met together. And they met together for one thing: to praise His name. The Bible says also here, praise Him in His mighty firmament. When we come to God's house and we worship Him, yes, He is with us, but we also recognize where He is seated at this very moment. The word firmament is just another word for in the heavens. He is seated on His throne in the great expanse of heaven. The worship scenes that we saw in Isaiah and Revelation, where did they see the Lord? High and lifted up where? In glory, on His throne. We come here to worship the Lord. He is in our midst, but He is ruling and reigning at the same time in glory. Can you truly sing this morning, we have come into His house and gathered in His name to worship Him? Friends, we are told to praise Him. We are told where to praise Him at. And point number three, verse number two, we see why we praise Him. Look at verse number two again. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. We praise the Lord for His mighty acts. We praise Him for His excellent greatness. What He has done, and the reason He does the things He does, is because of who He is. We have come here because of what He has done. Do you know from Genesis to Revelation is just a collection, a recording of what God's amazing and mighty acts have been throughout redemptive history? It is a record of what God alone can do. This God alone, this one who said, the psalmist says, praise him for his mighty acts. Well, what are his mighty acts? This is the God who created the whole universe in 6 days just by speaking. This is the God who led the children of Israel while they were in the wilderness and eventually led them into the land flowing with milk and honey. This is the God who is the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us. And we come today because we beheld his glory, the only glory of the only begotten Son of the Father. This is the God who healed the sick and raised the dead. This is the God who fed the multitudes with a little boy's sack lunch. This is the God who bled and suffered and died for us on an old rugged cross. This is the God who walked out of the grave on the third day because death could not hold him and the grave could not keep him. This is the God who is one day returning for his own. This is who we praise, and this is why we praise. He is the one who saved you, he has redeemed you, and he has justified you through his act on the cross before a holy God. He is the one who has cleansed you and set you free from the bondage of sin. He has delivered you and he has sealed you with his Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. This same God has written your name forever in the Lamb's Book of Life if you have called upon him for salvation. This same God has gone to prepare a place for you. And if he's gone to prepare that place for you, one day he is coming back to take you home so that you will be with him forever. And the reason he did all that and so much more is because of his greatness, his excellent greatness he has for us. Yet we don't have a reason to praise this morning. Praise of our mighty God should never get old because of what he has done for you and me. That job you have, God gave it to you. That job you thought you really wanted, but for some reason you never did it, God was protecting you from something. That family that you're sitting with this morning, there's one who blessed you with that family. This church family that you sit with every Sunday and Wednesday when you come into this house, it is a blessing from God. He is worthy of your praise because of what he has done. And finally, we are instructed on how to praise the Lord. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. I should have told you to bring your trumpet. Praise him with the lute, the harp, the tremble. Even praise him with the dance. Y'all, my idea is interpretive dance. That's the first time you've ever told me, y'all. I came out from behind the pulpit because that is a lie. That is not my spiritual gift. I've seen some that have it, but not me. Praise him with the tremble, praise him with the dance, praise him with stringed instruments and flutes, praise him with loud cymbals, praise him with clashing cymbals. What's the song saying? It is more than okay to use your talents and abilities in worship service. Praise him. It's more than okay to use more than just a piano organ. If that's all you got, but it's okay to use more, because the Bible says gives his command here. Again, trumpets, lutes, harps, trembles, string instruments, flutes, cymbals, and even with the dance. What I'm saying is we find no command forbidding instruments in our time of praise. Actually, we find the opposite. We see God commanding us to use the talents and abilities that he has given us not to bring the focus of praise upon ourselves, not to put the spotlight on what we are doing, but to put the spotlight on you. Use your gifts, your talents and abilities in whatever way God has gifted you to praise the Lord. I don't know about you, if you read the Bible, there's going to be instruments in heaven. There is. Singing will be in heaven. The Bible says we're going to sing a new song. What is that song? I don't know. It's going to be new, but we're going to sing it. I do know we're going to sing holy, holy, holy a whole lot. My point is this. If singing and instruments are used in times of praise and glory, they should be used in the church house of God. It's okay. Basically, what the Bible is saying here, praise sometimes is just not by saying amen. These things, praise is also expressed. It's an expression. Express yourself in worship. Not talking about emotionalism, it's talking about spirit, feel, praise. You might not be singing that good. Sing anyway. You're not here to impress nobody. You're singing for the one who redeems you. If you had to sing good to sing in the choir, Lanny would have. My singing is about as good as my dancing. But whether you or I can sing good or play an instrument or not good, I believe he closed out verse 6 for this important reason. Let everything be happy for me. Pray. It don't take much to breathe. But that's just a natural response. What the Bible is saying, I believe, is this. You might not can do this, that, or the other. You might not can play the organ. You might not can play the piano. You might not can play the guitar. You might not can play the trumpet. You might not can play the drum. But if you breathe, you can still praise Jesus. You can still praise Jesus. Why? Because he so let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And then he puts an emphatic exclamation point on by repeating it again. Praise the Lord. Who has blessed you with the gift of life? God. Who is sustaining your life right now? God. Use it to praise and bless him each and every day. One day in heaven, everyone and everything that is in it will be there to do one thing. You're going to be there to praise the Lord. May it be of IBC on this day and the days ahead that God has given us in the future, that everything that we do points to our praise of him. Simply in closing, God wants you to praise him. When you decide that he is the reason why you are here, and you truly remember all that he has done to redeem and save you, there is going to come from you and me grand praise. I think sometimes we just forget what God has truly done for us. Just remember what God has done for you. It'll bring praise and joy to your heart. Tony Evans said this, worship is a spark that is the result of people falling in love with their Savior. Worship is a spark that is the result of people falling in love with their Savior. My question this morning is, do you love Jesus? If you truly do, praise his name. Let's pray for you. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for these messages that have been devoted totally to the worship of you. And Lord, I pray that you'll just use this invitation time Lord, is the time of praise. People may want to come to this altar and just praise you. There may be some that come in here with the weight of the world on their shoulders. And Lord, this may be a time they can leave that weight here. He tells in the Gospel of Matthew to cast all of our burdens upon you. You're the one who can carry those burdens. Lord, there may be somebody here today, and they're sitting through these messages, and they realize the reason they're truly not praising you is because they're not saved, and they need to be saved. And today can be the day of salvation where they repent of their sins and believe on Jesus forevermore. And then they'll definitely have something to praise you with. But God, we just pray for your Holy Spirit to intercede during this time to have this will away in our service. In Jesus' name, amen.